Hello everyone, I'm Dr. Snehal Santosh Rathi and my topic of presentation is multiplanar and dynamic contrast enhanced MRI evaluation of mixed cystic and solid cellar masses. Aims and introduction. Aim is to re-emphasize and evaluate MRI findings in mixed cystic and solid cellar mass by dynamic contrast enhanced study. The cellar region is one of the most anatomically complex areas in the brain. It encompasses the bony cella turcica and pituitary gland, plus all the normal structures that surround it. Advances in imaging techniques have enabled visualization of vital neural and vascular structures involving the cellar region. Computed tomography is useful in delineation of the osseous margin of the cella. It is particularly helpful in evaluating the bone changes related to pathologic processes. MRI provides detailed information about the contents of the cella and paracellar regions. It is a fundamental pre-operative and post-operative imaging modality. Multiplanar capability and superior tissue contrast differentiation render magnetic resonance imaging the preferred method for examining patients with pituitary axis dysfunction. Methods. This was a retrospective study conducted at MGM Hospital, Navi Mumbai, over a span of 1 year. Sample size was of 70 patients. Symptomatic patients having hyperprolactin and hypogonadism and known cases of pituitary masses were subjected to MRI evaluation by using Toshiba 1.5 Tesla scanner and following sequences with small FOV targeting the cell away taken. T1, small FOV coronal and sagittal sequence. T2, coronal, axial and sagittal sequence. T1, contrast, dynamic and delayed contrast. Diffusion-weighted imaging, ADC, flared axial. Results, out of the 70 suspected cases for pituitary mass, the following table shows the number of cases and the type. So, solid enhancing pituitary region mass, around 10 cases were seen. Mixed and cystic and solid pituitary region mass, around 35 cases were seen. Cystic pituitary region mass, 5 cases were seen. Purely intracellular pituitary mass, 5 cases were seen. Pituitary region mass with intrinsic high T1 signal intensity, 10 cases were seen. And normal were around 5. So out of these 70 cases, 35 cases showed mixed cystic and solid pituitary region mass. Pituitary macroadenoma were of sample size was around 20. Pituitary microadenoma around 5. Craniopharyngioma around 10. In our study, we review the imaging findings of mixed cystic and solid pituitary region mass. On MRI imaging, first, pituitary macroadenoma. On T1 sequence, it typically isointense to gray matter. Larger lesions are often heterogeneous and vary in signal due to area of cystic change, necrosis, and hemorrhage. On T2 flare sequence, on T2 weighted imaging, typically isointense to gray matter. Larger lesions are often heterogeneous and vary in signal due to areas of cystic change, necrosis, hemorrhage. Hypersignal intensity can be seen along optic pathways on T2 flare in which macroadenomas compress the optic nerve. T1 on T1 contrast, dynamic and delayed. Solid components demonstrate moderate to bright enhancement. Subtle neural tail is noted. On diffusion-weighted ADC and GRE imaging, hemorrhagic adenomas bloom on GRE. So on extension or involvement, pituitary adenomas greater than 10 mm in size, superiorly optic nerve compression, laterally cavernous sinus invasion, and inferiorly invade cella turcica. Following are the images of pituitary macroadenoma, T1 contrast coronal, sagittal image, and T2 axial. The second is craniopharyngioma, edmontonomatous type. T1 sequence, signal intensity varies with cyst content. Cystic component is hypo to hypersignal intense compared with brain. T2 flare sequence, cysts are variable hypersignal intense on T2 flare. Solid nodule is often calcified and moderately hypointense. Hyperintensity extending along the optic tract is common and is due to edema, not tumor invasion. T1 contrast, dynamic and delayed. Cyst walls and solid nodules typically enhance following contrast administration. Calcification, if present, shows blooming on GRA. So these are the images of craniopharyngioma, coronal T2 flare, axial T1 contrast. Sorry, T1 contrast coronal. Pituitary mass, pituitary microadenoma. On T1 sequence, usually isointense to normal pituitary. T2 flare sequence, variable but often a little hyperintense. T1 contrast, dynamic and delayed. Post-contrast and especially thin section dynamic contrast enhanced imaging is an important part of a pituitary MRI and has significantly improved diagnostic accuracy. Dynamic sequences demonstrate a rounded region of delayed enhancement compared to the rest of the gland. Delayed images are variable, ranging from hyperenhancement, most common, to isointense to the rest of the gland, to hyperintense, retained contrast. Involvement and extension. A microadenoma is less than 10 mm in size. Bulkiness of the gland on the side of the microadenoma, subtle remodeling of the floor of the cella and deviation of the pituitary infundibulum away from the adenoma. Following are the images of pituitary microadenoma, T1 post-contrast, sagittal, coronal, and T2 axial. Discussion. Anatomy. In the sagittal plane, the cella turcica is a midline shallow depression in the posterior sphenoid bone that contains the pituitary gland. The floor of the cella turcica is variable in appearance, depending largely on the degree of aeration of the underlying sphenoid sinus. The cortical bone and air-filled sinus may merge imperceptibly on MR images. The dorsalmost aspect of the sphenoid bone descends to from the clivus. The roof of the cella turcica is formed by dural reflection, the diaphragm cellae. This thin membrane is inconsistently visualized on MR images, but is best seen on long TR, short TE images. The two lobes of the pituitary gland are embryologically, physiologically, and anatomically distinct. The adenohypophysis is isointense relative to gray matter on T1 weighted images. The neurosecretory material in neurohypophysis produces a high signal intensity evident on most T1 weighted images with normal findings. Adenomas are often classified by size. Microadenomas are 10 mm or less in diameter, and macroadenomas are greater than 10 mm in diameter. Pituitary macroadenoma originate within the pituitary gland and result in expansion of the cella. They are soft tumors with a propensity to erode bone and typically show mild heterogeneous enhancement. Density, signal intensity, and enhancement features are not distinctive, but cellular enlargement and erosion, cavernous sinus invasion, and lobulated margins are reliable indicators of an adenoma. Most commonly, such tumors extend the cephala toward the optic chiasma and hypothalamus or laterally into the cavernous sinus. Pituitary macroadenomas can expand the cella and extend into the supracellar region. They may also show hemorrhagic or proteinaceous cystic changes with T1 hyperintensity, mimicking craniopharyngiomas, but they rarely calcify. The solid portions typically enhance uniformly, whereas the necrotic, cystic, or hemorrhagic portions do not. Macroadenomas can expand laterally and invade the cavernous sinus. When hemorrhage or apoplexy occurs in supracellular adenomas, susceptibility-weighted sequences are helpful to identify blood products, which can be markedly hypointense on T2-weighted images. Pituitary apoplexy is an emergency that can result in permanent visual loss if not immediately addressed. Craniopharyngiomas are benign epithelial tumors known to arise from squamous breasts along the remnants of hypophyseal Rathke duct. They are most commonly supracellular in location but can also be mixed intrasupracellular or rarely purely intracellular. Varying locations occur because they can arise anywhere along the pituitary stalk from the third ventricle to the pituitary gland. A small number of craniopharyngiomas can be ectopic, located in the third ventricle, nasopharynx, or sphenoid sinus. Giant craniopharyngiomas are known to extend into anterior, middle, or posterior cranial fossa. Craniopharyngioma is the most common non-glial pediatric intracranial tumor and comprises over half of all pediatric supracellular tumors. The peak incidence is between 10 to 14 years of age, with second peak in the fourth to sixth decade. The most common symptoms at presentation are headache, visual field defects, or anterior pituitary dysfunction. Craniopharyngioma vary in size, with larger tumors being predominantly cystic and complex with a multilobulated appearance. Nearly 90% of the adventinomatous variant of craniopharyngiomas have calcification in cysts and demonstrate enhancement of the wall or solid portions, which are distinguishing imaging features. The cystic areas can be of varying signal intensity on T1 weighted images, depending on the protein or cholesterol content. The solid portion can also be heterogeneous on T1 and T2 sequences. The detection of pituitary microadenomas on MR images strongly depends on the image contrast between the microadenoma and normal pituitary tissue. Contrast-enhanced MR imaging has been extensively used to improve image contrast and hence improve the detection of microadenomas. Post-contrast and especially thin section dynamic contrast-enhanced imaging is an important part of a pituitary MRI and has significantly improved diagnostic accuracy. Dynamic sequence demonstrate a rounded region of delayed enhancement compared to the rest of the gland. Delayed images are variable, ranging from hypo-enhancement to iso-intense to the rest of the gland to hyper-intense retained contrast. Conclusion, we assess the MR imaging characteristic of 70 pathologically or clinically proved cellar lesions. Adenoma and craniopharyngioma constituted major lesions in a series. The MR imaging characteristics of the most common lesions were sufficiently distinct to allow them to be differentiated from each other and from most other entities. Other characteristics such as extracellular versus intracellular location, nature of contrast material enhancement, the presence of cystic components and clinical findings permit further differentiation among various other abnormalities. The superior resolution and multiple planar capacity of MR imaging best depicts the extent of cellar and extracellular lesions. These are my references. Thank you.